Today on Nerd Out, Aiken. Welcome back to Nerd Out, the show where we take a look at Cardano. We break it down, but we don't dumb it down. Today, we're looking at a new programming language on Cardano called Aiken. And without further ado, let us dive into it. So this is Aiken. This is their cool looking logo. And we're going to do a quasi deep dive on it today. So Aiken is used to write smart contracts on Cardano. It produces Plutist V2 code in the end. But it's kind of it's designed to be a little bit of a nicer language. So what is Aiken? It is a bespoke smart contract language for Cardano. It's not something like a higher level language like Haskell that's used for all kinds of things. It's a specific language designed just for writing smart contracts. As you'll see, it's very similar looking. A lot of the syntax looks very similar to Rust. The tool itself is built in Rust, and some of the goals that they've specified for the project are they want it to be easy to use, safe to use, kind of works out of the box, and it's opinionated on the way it wants you to do things. So that is what Aiken is. So how does it work? Let's start from the very lowest level and kind of work our way up to the Aiken language level. So at the very lowest level inside the Cardano node executes flattened untyped Plutus core code, also known as UPLC. UPLC is a binary format. So if you're looking at a transaction that runs a smart contract on Cardano Stan or C Explorer, you're gonna see it in this just a blob of hex numbers. So this is untyped Plutus core UPLC code. And then it's also wrapped in CBOR. So it's wrapped in like a CBOR array, just because that's the way everything on Cardano is put on the chain. So it's binary code wrapped in CBOR. And it executes based on a state-based virtual machine. So it's the engine just goes through different steps. And in the end, for most smart contracts, what you're trying to get to is a true or a false, whether or not the contract is allowed to run and spin the UTXO or mint the transact or mint the token or do the thing that you've asked the contract to validate that you're allowed to do. So at the lowest level, we're dealing with flattened untyped Plutus core. So a step above that is the text representation of UPLC code. And this looks a little bit like Lisp. So this is where you have Lisp-like code. It's very lambda-focused, so functions inside of functions, that it has a way of compiling all this up into kind of a functional program that can be executed on an engine that is used to doing lambda calculus. Lambda calculus is kind of a core engine that is used for many of the functional programming languages like Haskell, for example. But yeah, this is what it looks like. Everything at this level has a single input and a single output. And so if you had like a function that takes two inputs, it would break that up in the untyped Plutus core into two functions where the output of one would be used as the input to the next. So it's basically a way of breaking it down into very small parts. You can think of this as kind of like the assembly code of Plutus, if you will. And the binary is like the machine code of Plutus. So let's go a level higher and let's take a look at Aiken code. So Aiken code lives at this higher, nice level where you can actually see what it's doing. But it does compile down into UPLC text code. And as you notice, it looks a lot like Rust. In fact, it's very, very much like Rust. But it is limited in what you can do and the built-in functions that you can access. You can only access functions that they've either written the translation into untyped Plutus core or the built-in functions into Plutus itself. So there's a number of built-in Plutus functions like doing a hash or something like that that are built into Plutus. So this is a hello world contract. Basically, it allows the UTXO to be spent if I send in a redeemer value of hello world exactly. If I don't send in that, it won't let me spend the UTXO. And also, it has to have the correct signer. So it's validating that the transaction I'm signing the smart contract transaction with, or the key I'm signing the transaction with, is the same one that that was provided in the original datum as the owner. So how this works is you first lock a UTXO in the contract. So I send it in with a datum of, with the owner key. And then when I try to spend it, it's going to check to make sure the same key is the one that locked it. And so that's what this is doing, this spend function here. It gets in the datum that comes from the input UTXO I'm trying to spend, and then the redeemer value, which should contain hello world. And then it also gets this script context. The context tells me like who signed the transaction and a whole bunch of other data I could look at, but I'm only really looking at this extra signatories here. So basically I'm saying the redeemer message must match and the extra signatures must contain the datum owner signature. And so we can also write tests. So I've broken out the two things into separate functions because it's kind of hard to test the contract function itself because I'd have to mock that script object and it's kind of a mess. So I broke things out into separate functions. So I have two different tests. One is for validating the signers. So I've got tests here that is the positive case and the negative case. So I'm validating that if the owner signature does not match the signature I'm providing, then it should return a false. And the same thing, if it matches, if they're the same, it should return a true. And the same thing goes for the hello world. If I pass in the words hello world as the redeemer, that'll be return me a true. If I pass in aluminum falcon, then it'll return me a false. So you can do testing of your smart contract right there in the same files as you're writing your smart contract, which is pretty nice. Some other thoughts. So it's still very alpha. It's not a complete system yet, but it's promising so far for what you can do. The output contracts are not yet optimized, so it'll spit out some pretty complex UPLC code, especially if you break things out into a bunch of different functions. It'll cost more to run that contract than if you jammed everything inside the main spend function. But that's stuff that can be optimized later, for inlining of functions and inlining of variables and other stuff that they can do some optimization. But that's stuff coming in the future. I also took a brief look at some other projects in the same vein. So the main problem these languages are trying to solve is to give us a Plutus specific language for Cardano that's not just Haskell. And the Helios project is doing that. If you look at the code from there, it looks very much like Go. I haven't tested that one. I haven't tested any of these other ones myself yet. I'm just kind of putting them out here for your information. Plutarch is also a Haskell-based one, but that tries to sit a little bit closer to the UPLC code. So their goal is to make very optimized smart contracts. So if you've got a contract, it's written in Plutus TX and you want to optimize it for cost or performance, take a look at Plutarch. There's also PluTS. That one is based on TypeScript, and that's also something kind of in the same vein, trying to solve the same problem. And also note that I am not a smart contract expert yet. I'm still learning smart contracts along with everyone else. All I've demoed here today is basically the Hello World app for smart contracts. And the last thought I want to leave you with is 2023, with all of these tools coming out, getting ready, it's going to look very interesting for smart contracts and smart contract developers. So if you remember, Charles Hoskinson came out with a video a long while ago talking about the pond, the island, and the ocean. And the pond was related to Ethereum and Solidity. It's a small little insular ecosystem. The island is where you have kind of this pristine island in the middle of the ocean, that's the ideal way of doing a smart contract. And that's kind of what Plutus represents. And so what we're really doing with these tools is we're kind of growing a bigger island. We're not capturing the ocean yet. We're not like pulling in every Java developer or, every C and C++ developer or anything like that. That's the ocean. But this is where I see, you know, the island is kind of, we're growing a bigger island. We're still in within the realm of Plutus, though. So 2023 is going to be interesting. And with that, Nerd out.